This is Dr. Cheryl Fellman, and welcome to What Women Must Know, a show empowering you with truthful information and inspiring ideas, and hopefully allowing you to make really informed decisions about your health and well-being. And as always, it's a pleasure having you join me today for another really fascinating conversation. Before we go there, I do have a few announcements. I have a couple of trips coming up for 2020. One of those trips will be to Costa Rica, and I will be taking a group to the Rhythmia Life Advancement Center in Costa Rica, which is a week-long program, and it is a week of profound transformation and healing and connection to your soul. We are doing, this is the fourth year I've taken a group there. We will be working with plant medicine, with traditional plant medicine from the Amazon, known as ayahuasca, a very profound journey. I've just witnessed miracles since I have taken my groups there. And that's happening February 9th for a week. And if you're interested, you can contact me for more information. The second trip I'm taking, 2020 is a big year for adventures, and October of 2020, I'm taking a small group of people to Bhutan, and if you're wondering where Bhutan is, it's actually a country of 735,000 people that is sandwiched between India and China. And what makes Bhutan so special is that it is, aside from magnificent countryside, just beautiful landscape, a country that is really very environmentally aware, but it is also the only true, pure Buddhist country in the world. It has a minister of gross national happiness. It's a very unique place. It's a very ancient place. It's a country of great spirituality. So if you're up for an adventure, I am working with a wonderful local tour group, and we have many experiences in store for you on that 12-day experience. That goes from October 19th to October 31st, and that's in a year, 2020, but with Bhutan, because they have limited visas and limited hotel accommodations, we actually need to get people making a commitment sooner, at least by the beginning of the year. So all of these things will be on my website, and if you need to contact me for more information, please do. If you're ready for some transformation, for an adventure, you have some opportunities there. Okay, and one more thing. If you want to find out more about what I'm doing, go to my website, Dr. Cheryl Fellman. That's DR for Dr. Cheryl Fellman.com, or my Facebook, which is What Women Must Know. So, okay, that's it. Announcements out of the way. And on to our show. So, in July and August, I was in Australia, and I was a speaker at a conference called the Nutrition Summit. It was a fantastic summit. They had some really inspiring people there, and I met someone who totally inspired me. You know, there was lots of information about nutrition and what's happening with toxicity in the land and glyphosate and things that are really important for us to know about. But on the other hand, it's kind of depressing to hear what's going on and the consequences from our ignorance and how we deal with our food and our land and our health. And then I was just thrilled to be sitting in the audience and listening to my guest speak. And he is Charles Massy, and I'm going to share a little bit about him. But I want to just say I was really profoundly inspired and uplifted and felt just like there is hope in the world, and I wanted to share his message with all of my wonderful listeners. So I'm so glad we have him here with us today, all the way from Australia. And before I introduce him, just let me share a little bit about him with you. So Charles gained a Bachelor of Science in Zoology and Human Ecology in 1976 before going farming for 35 years and developing the prominent Merino sheep stud Severn Park, Concern at ongoing land degradation and humanity's sustainability challenge led him to return to the university in 2009 to undertake a PhD in human ecology. Charles was awarded an Order of Australia Medal for his services as chair and director of a number of research organizations and statutory wool boards. He has also served on national and international review panels in sheep and wool research and development in genomics. Charles has authored several books on the Australian sheep and wool industry, the most recent being the widely acclaimed Breaking the Sheep's Back, which was shortlisted for the Prime Minister's Australian Literary Awards in Australian History in 2012. And Call of the Reed Warbler, A New Agriculture, A New Earth, by Charles' fourth book, is now attaining bestseller status and has been shortlisted for the 2018 Queensland Literary Awards and Nonfiction Award and the 2018 Waverley Library Award and the 2018 ABIA Book Awards, Small Publishers Adult Books of the Year. Wow, lots of accomplishments. And I am just going to get into our conversation and welcome Charles all the way from Australia. So hello, Charles, and welcome.
Hi, Cheryl, and I'd say good morning, but it's probably evening for you, I suspect.
Well, yes. Yes, you know, we always had to really check on the time difference, and there was daylight savings just happened in Australia. It hasn't quite happened here, so we just had to really synchronize our clocks to make sure we would find each other at the right time, and we did, so I'm thrilled. So I really want to say to you how grateful I am for the wonderful work you're doing. It was very moving, and I have to say just who you are and your passion for what you do just really moved all of us in the audience. You know, it was like brought us all to tears, actually. And your message and what you are bringing into the world is so profound. So to help people understand what your work is, let's just begin with a little bit of your history and what got you to this mission that you are now involved with restorative agriculture and regenerative agriculture to the land.
Yeah, look, thanks, Cheryl. As you pointed out, I grew up on a farm here in, I can't think of anything similar in the States. It's not as cold as your Montana country, but we can get to minus 14 and yet 40 degrees through the day, so over 100 degrees Fahrenheit and whatever minus 14 Celsius is. So it's a beautiful high landscape I live in. Sorry, did you want to say something?
Yeah, and I was going to say, where is that in Australia?
Oh, it's in on the eastern side of Australia, south of our national capital, Canberra, and a bit further south of Sydney. So you'd be aware where Sydney is on the east coast. So we're about 6 hours drive south. And look, I had to come home and take up managing the farm when I was 22. I left university, finished part-time to do that because my father had a heart attack. And I became what I thought was a good industrial farmer. I used to plough the country, the paddocks, and put in monoculture to crops and a lot of fertilizer. Later on, I even used a bit of glyphosate, Roundup, for a couple of years. And then I had a series of tough experiences. We had five-year droughts where no rain and all the country went to dirt and things like that. And I suddenly realized, even though I loved nature, which is why I'd done zoology, I was working against my own deep inner feelings and beliefs by harming nature, our broad landscapes. And it was through reflecting on trying to fight, the very word fight a drought, you can't beat nature, but to defend our valuable sheep genetics, which we sell wool into Italy and places, I kept too many sheep and we kept feeding them grain to keep them alive, hurt the landscape and ended up with a big debt. So that was a shock. And slowly through those experiences and then we sold a lot of sheep across Australia into six states, 400 more rams a year, and I visited those clients and started to find some of the clients interested in our innovative genetics were doing really interesting things with their farming, that the new, what we call regenerative agriculture. They were very cleverly using animals, cattle and sheep, to healthily, ecologically graze landscapes, or they were getting away from industrial chemicals and using some of the new methods in organic regenerative cropping. And it was an epiphany for me. I suddenly realized there is a different way to do things that doesn't harm the earth but regenerates it and allows biodiversity, healthy soils to grow. And as I'm sure we'll discuss, if you get healthy soils where the biology drives the system, not the chemicals, you get a huge range of nutrients that Mother Nature's co-evolved those landscapes for and for us to eat. And that all impacts on human health. So it's an holistic view of farming and very exciting. And we swung over to it in the last two or three decades.
So where have we gone off the rails with agriculture in Australia, in the United States, I would say in many countries? What is it that we've done that has gotten us off the rails, and what have been the consequences for that?
That's a terrific question, and as you know better than me, there's been plenty of books and large books written on it. A quick summary would be that if you look at our Indigenous people and your Indigenous people, the American Indians or the Australian Aboriginal, and we probably had 300 or 400 different nations, just like you have a huge variety. Or if you even look at a medieval peasant, if you imagine Bruegel the Elder's painting of harvest in the 1500s, those cultures were what you could call of an organic mind. They saw themselves as indivisible with Mother Earth. What you did to the mother, you did to yourself. But following the scientific revolution and the Renaissance from the 1500s, 1600s, which then in turn led to the Industrial Revolution and the Capitalist Revolution, and it was a wonderful period of human evolution. But the end result, and this has been beautifully written about by one of your lead historians, Caroline Merchant, who wrote a book called The Death of Nature. She describes this whole philosophical shift, because the end of that result of all those centuries of brilliant thinking and research, but we ended up with what you could call a mechanical mind, where the modern Western and now spreading worldwide approach to our Earth is what you call mechanical, where we see the Earth as a substrate from which we extract profit, not something that is indivisibly bound with our own health, mental and physical. So that is a huge shift in the human mind, and indeed a schism that's erupted now between us and the Earth. And that was epitomized particularly post the Second World War, when we had all the munitions left over, chemical stockpiles, phosphate, explosives, etc., and the rise of modern industrial agriculture occurred, and from that the Green Revolution, where we now saw, and this was all driven by the giant multinationals, the big pharmaceutical, the big chemical companies, the big fertilizer companies, the big food processing companies, where we industrialized the production of food, which meant killing off the soil, pouring on chemicals, over-aggressive tillage, and then extreme things like genetically modifying these sensitive organisms, to the stage today where virtually for every ton of food we produce, say, off the Mississippi Basin, about 10 tons of soil is wasted, and let alone without the poisons and stuff being put into it, because we've killed the biology that delivers those, that huge range of nutrients. So it's a massive shift in the human mind and practice of farming and growing food. But the consequences now, as you look at the exponential rise of all our modern health diseases, parallels that development. We have, by killing our natural systems, we're now paying the consequences with human health.
because it brings us back to the circle of life, how everything is connected. And because we've engaged in a mechanistic view of, like you were saying, extracting resources out of the earth, we have really lost that connection, which is who we are. We're part of that. And I really learned that so profoundly when I go to Costa Rica and I work with the plant medicine, the intelligence of the medicine, and it definitely has an intelligence. And one of the big messages that the shaman were giving and people experience directly is how profoundly disconnected we are from nature, and how harmful, how destructive it is to us as individuals, for our well-being, our health, and as a society, when we disconnect from nature, because we are nature, and we're hurting ourselves as we destroy nature, or at least lose our contact with nature. And it's just brought a whole level of awareness to me about this connection and the need to connect and the need to honor the mother, Mother Earth, as a living being, and work with that intelligence of the earth. And I think that's what touched me so much about what you're doing, and with regenerative agriculture as a whole, this whole movement is understanding. It's like coming full circle, right, to a place where we were connected and understood how to work with nature to bring through the abundance that nature has for us, to be disconnected and then suffering with droughts and fires and all the and diseases that never used to plague us before.
Cheryl, that's a really great summary in those few minutes. It's And it comes back to that, the arrogance that goes with the mechanical mind, that we think we are somehow separate from nature, when really we are very much co-evolve within nature, to interact with nature, for nature to impact even today on switching on our genes and switching them off, what's called epigenetics, that the whole thing is just this extraordinary constant co-evolving interaction, and to think that we can somehow stand aside and interfere in that is truly alarming. And even down to little things like, our species really evolved for about a million years as a modern hominid in the African savanna. And I'm thinking about the issues of obesity. I mean, if we were hardwired in that tough environment where you're going to run out of food for a while, and so it's advantageous, for example, to store fat, because that's immediate energy that you can convert when you run into the hard times. But our modern industrial lifestyles and junk food and our destruction of healthy food means that we lay down too much fat, and that leads to all the obesity issues. So look, that's just one really small example. And I guess touching on that full circle point you've made, that's what really excites me about this new regenerative agriculture. It's as we find out more and more about, for example, the extraordinary co-evolution of soil microorganisms and earthworms and how they interact, and how the beneficial fungus in the soil or your microhouse of fungi source our nutrients and control disease and stuff. Just how extraordinarily nature functions, and the hope is that what we're doing with regenerative agriculture, which is using natural functions, natural inputs, grazing animals, we are getting back to empowering those long millions of years of co-evolution to drive the system rather than us simplifying and dominating. And from that comes remarkable regeneration, both of landscapes and food and whole ecosystems, and that's why it is a story of hope, as you pointed out. It's in a time, mind you, where we humans look like now we have started to actually even destabilize Earth's nine interrelated systems, what's now called the Anthropocene. So things like regenerative agriculture and our connection with the urban people who eat food and buy fiber off those healthy landscapes, we can actually play a huge role in addressing this modern climate and water, et cetera, other issues that goes as we enter into the Anthropocene. So great story of hope, isn't it?
It is. You know, having lived many years in Australia, I was horrified at some of the practices I learned, where the farmers who had paddocks would poison the trees and kill the trees off, and the soil was small amount of topsoil on Australian landscape, such an ancient land. You know, the story you usually hear about how poor Australian soils are. And then I came across the book of Bruce Pascoe, which I've interviewed on my program, and I know you know who he is. You've probably met him. But he, just briefly for people listening, someone who has Aboriginal ancestries, went back, and also an academic, went back to the original sources of adventurers and settlers, and found that in the early days of Australia, when the Europeans just arrived, it was an incredibly fertile land, and it had an abundance of plants and food and fish and there was this harmony in this landscape, which I was shocked. I had no idea. That isn't the story we've ever been told about Australia. And it was such a revelation, first of all, to realize what had been done to the Australian landscape and to the soils and to just the whole environment, but also the it's like what you're doing. It just runs parallel, doesn't it, to Charles? Because he's talking about ways to regenerate the land based on what his ancestors did, as you are doing in your way in regenerating the land and understanding how to bring life back into the soils and into the landscape and into the animals and the natural systems of that land. It was just a stunning, it was a stunning revelation for me.
Cheryl, again, there's so many issues you're touching on there. Yes, Bruce Pascoe is a friend of mine, and I work with an Aboriginal senior lawman, what you might call a shaman in your country, a local Ngarrigo man that we've become friends, and I'll tell you what, I feel like I'm in kindergarten. So just to capture what you've alluded to, unlike your New England-type country where the first European settlers arrived, and that happened 200 years before here in Australia, when the first settlers came, they came from northwestern Europe, England, almost rich post-glacial soils, so the soils had a lot of nutrients, very mild, soft environment, lots of rain, plenty of humidity. And they hit this continent, which is largely semi-desert or it's certainly not very only small pockets, anything like your New England type country. And some of our soils are three-quarters of the age of the Earth, 3.8 billion years, so there's not many nutrients there and a very dry climate. We don't have Mississippi rivers or big mountain chains that can feed the centre of the continent. And so these settlers arrived with two things. They arrived with thinking they were in similar country. I'm talking about the early 1800s, a similar country as Europe, and that's understandable. And so they brought their ideas and tools and ploughs, which were totally unsuited to this fragile landscape. But the second thing that they did was they arrived with the arrogance that the indigenous people were primitive. Well, in fact, indigenous Australia is one of the oldest, if not the oldest, living peoples and civilization on Earth. They've been going over about 65,000 years, we know now, into 400 different nations and language groups. Those nations pretty much occupy distinct ecological zones and this extraordinarily sophisticated culture, including through all the ice ages of droughts that went for 10,000 years and stuff. They somehow survived and evolved extraordinary religious, mythological belief systems that were almost all in a deep way developed around sustaining Mother Earth. And so when the Europeans arrived, they just thought these people were primitive and there's untold massacres and pushing out of country of these people. But as you point out, the knowledge they had is only now being reawoken by people like Bruce Pascoe and another humble scientist and historian, Bill Gamage, who wrote about how they use fire to control grasslands for kangaroo harvesting, etc., etc. So, and part of my epiphany in shifting over was becoming friends with the senior lawman locally. And we now run every year in the autumn a workshop for how you use fire to constructively stimulate Australian grasslands, etc. And listening to his view and how we've changed the land and what it was like has just been a revelation, and makes me feel like a beginner at sitting at his feet sort of thing. So you're quite right to touch on the importance of the indigenous element in our landscape culture, and it's been a shameful history, but there is a movement across the board in many areas to embrace that, to understand, to apologise, to reconcile, etc. But it's slow coming.
Well, it can't come fast enough, can it? I know that you are traveling all over the world because you've become quite a renowned person in teaching about regenerative agriculture. You know, we had a hard time coordinating our schedules because you were traveling everywhere. And I mean, that must inspire and uplift you to see the interest and the openness that's happening worldwide to reclaim nature, you know, re-heal the land.
Absolutely, Cheryl, and you know, meeting people like yourself, for example. I've deliberately chosen to travel, even though it's exhausting, for a number of reasons. My book, which is now published in America by Chelsea Green, great little publisher in the ecology area, stimulated sort of more worldwide interest. And you learn a lot. You're dealing with some of the world's leading thinkers in different areas, great farmers and scientists and health people. So you never stop learning, as you would more than acknowledge, I know. But I truly believe, and there's more and more science supporting it, that in terms of the human health challenge we now have, and I think America is the same as Australia, if we don't rapidly address just two of the major modern diseases, which is connected to everything we've been talking about, I'm talking about just obesity and autism alone, if we don't address that, those two alone will destroy any modern economy by the middle of this century. The burden on society is going to be so huge, and all those modern health diseases are growing exponentially. So the travel is just spreading ideas and feeding them is so exciting, because if you think about the issue I've just raised, the fact that it looks like we humans, through how we've desertified the earth with bad agricultural practice and the chemicals we're pouring in and the carbon we're pumping up, looks like we've pushed earth out of that stable previous 10 or 12,000 year period called the Holocene, which was why human agriculture evolved and then why human civilizations evolved. It was that perfect time for our species to thrive. But it looks like we've now pushed our planet into a more dangerous new era called the Anthropocene, a human-caused destabilization of the systems that sustain Earth. And everyone's hung up, and I'm not going to get into politics here either with you guys or us, but everyone's hung up on things like climate. But there's eight other systems to do with water, biodiversity. You know, for example, look at what's happening in the Amazon today. We are now in the sixth greatest extinction event our planet has ever witnessed. But this time it's caused by us. And you can't keep destroying biodiversity without everyone suffering. But then when you look at how regenerative agriculture is starting to impact those systems, it's extraordinary how healing it is. And one of your great and wonderful thinkers who I've become friends with is Paul Hawken. Written some great books like Blessed Unrest and The Ecology of Commerce, etc. He's recently written a book called Drawdown, where he co-opted 80-90 scientists to study the best ways of pulling down carbon dioxide just to address the climate issue, but that impacts on the water cycle and everything else. And getting to know Paul, I pointed out that in his top 20, about half of them are regenerative ag practices. If we just call them regenerative agriculture, what's number one at pulling down carbon from the atmosphere and putting it in the soil and regenerating everything? Well, it's in the regenerative agriculture by a country mile. And getting to know Paul now, he's now moving on to his next and major book, which will be Regeneration, where agriculture will play a key role. But I'm increasingly learning from scientists and farmers that as far as addressing the Anthropocene, we farmers, if we regenerate our landscapes, probably have the best solutions. And then if you look at human health, you know, if humanity swung back to what it was doing pre-medieval period, buying or growing healthy food full of nutrients and micronutrients, it's going to have a huge impact on human health. So it's a hell of a good story, isn't it?
It's a hell of a good story. So let's start with your property. Your land. How much? Tell us your story. Tell us about your land. How much land you had? What was happening when you were operating out of the old system? And then what did you have to do to learn to regenerate your property? And what has been the result?
Yeah, thanks, Cheryl. A good question. We've got a few thousand acres. A third of it, a bit less than a third, is natural thick forest and bush. So we got kangaroos and a couple of beautiful little wallabies that bounce around and other marsupials that glide around in trees and a lot of birds in there. But then a third of our country is granite, nearly half a billion years old. That was over-cleared by the early settlers. It was grassy woodland and hardly any trees left. And then we have beautiful, richer basalt, which is naturally treeless but rocky. So our native grasses have persisted there. And so I started farming, as I said, at 22, but aspired to be a good industrial farmer. I used to plough country, which basically kills all the soil biology and bears it. And so we suffered from droughts. Our animals often weren't healthy because they were trying to live on monocultures pumped up with things like superphosphate, which doesn't do them any good at all. And eventually, as I did explain before, I had a sort of epiphany that realized I was completely going against my own internal love of nature, my biophilia and all that sort of stuff. And I shifted. And I shifted because I saw these examples of people. In our case, we're not cropping country so much as grazing. We have cold, dry winters. So it's not suited to that. So the new grazing approaches that spread worldwide and tens of millions of hectares in your country and Australia and all the big continents, it's called holistic grazing management or mob grazing. It was evolved in Zimbabwe by a guy called Alan Saver. He was an ecologist there watching the large animal herds in their millions migrating, and he asked the question, how come those grasslands are the healthiest with such big mobs? And he realized the big mobs of animals were putting dung and urine into the soil, but they never overgrazed the country because the predators were always driving them. And so he then evolved a system for human management where you have higher density mobs instead of all lots of little size mobs, but you move them very frequently, just like those animal herds. And the result of that is huge regeneration of your grasslands. And that's really what is happening in the States with you people and in Australia and South America and Africa and increasingly around the world. And it's quite remarkable. When you shift to ecological grazing, which is cycling the ruminants, the minerals and nutrients and biology from the guts of the sheep and cattle, which is ruminant, that and the correct rests and the density stimulates production. In the best cases, you can get two or three times more production without having to use chemicals, production off the country, as opposed to the original costly, interfering, simplifying system. And the same is now happening in cropping around the world. You've got a well-known person in North Dakota, Gabe Brown, written a book also with Chelsea Green, where he's now, to grow his crops, he grows multi-species, a whole range of species that has an ecological function, because nature never works in monocultures. She's always worked in diverse pastures. Anyway, I won't bore you with the details, but there's ranges of cropping now, methods like Gabe Brown, which is, and he and others work closely with Australian soil biologists and farmers. There's another group of farmers here in Australia that have replaced all industrial inputs just by combining worm juice or vermi juice with compost extracts, so letting nature's inputs, and they are getting equivalent yields to industrial cropping with only 10% of the cost and no industrial harm. So there's a huge revolution for both cropping and grazing, and we're implementing the grazing, but I will use multi-species cover cropping to stimulate our degraded country. The second thing we've done is put a big focus onto our biodiversity. So our grasslands are regenerating with much more diversity and more insects and things. But the country that was over-cleared, as you described earlier, by the early settlers, we've now put in about 60,000 local provenance trees and shrubs in corridors and patches to get some function back into the country. And it's having an impact. We see, for example, we don't get destructive grasshopper plagues, which used to destroy us about every 6 or 8 years. We haven't had any since the late 80s now, and that's you couldn't put a monetary value on that. But we're seeing a lot more bird species. You know, we're over 140 bird species. We've had new species of wallabies and a solid little kangaroo called a wallaroo have emerged, and a lot more insects and so on. So, and that's actually economic benefit as well. The insects and the spiders have predated the grasshoppers. And I guess the other point that no one talks about, for all our family, and I'm lucky to have my oldest daughter and son-in-law and two grandchildren living on the farm while they teach in town, for all of us, we just revel in this increased biodiversity and its beauty of nature. You know, we can see the snowy mountains on one side and 40, 50 kilometres across to the coastal range. So it's a beautiful, if not at times harsh, environment, but the biodiversity just adds such meaning to what we're doing.
Such a wonderful story. You know, the question that came up to my mind was, I mean, so you had this land and it was monoculture and you were overgrazing and using the chemicals, and then you stopped and applied all the things you were just describing. Where do these creatures come from that were never there? Where, you know, where do these species of kangaroo, where were they before? How did they return?
Great question. A lot of our birds are migratory. They're smart enough to say, I'm going to get out of this winter here and go north into the Queensland tropics and have a good holiday sort of thing. And so increasing numbers of them are coming. And sadly, northern Australia and Queensland and my own state, New South Wales, are still what we call quite redneck. They still encourage land clearing because they're dominated by very conservative governments. I better be careful what I get into politics here, but you'd identify with that, I would think. And so the tree cover for these birds is decreasing, and we now find we are getting quite a lot of endangered or at-risk woodland birds that now have assumed residence here on our property as they migrate. The other thing we've got to advantage are one of the world's great national parks, the Kosciuszko National Park, the Alpine Park, about the size of Switzerland. It's only 40, 50 kilometres away cross country, and we have other remnant reserves. We're not far from the famous Snowy River. You'd remember the man from Snowy River. So it has vegetation corridors, and so that's where the repopulation comes from. And interestingly, things like in 2003, we had massive bushfires that destroyed half the mountain national park. And the mountain yellow robins that were never here, they were pushed out, and now they've become firm residents in both our gardens and on our farm because of the bush. So it's typical nature. It's adapting and fluxing, but once you create the positive environment for nature, she's smart enough and her creatures and insects, et cetera, to repopulate and take advantage.
So a couple of questions, because that's such an extraordinary story of profound transformation. So you don't get grasshopper plagues anymore on your property. Do your neighbors get grasshopper plagues?
Simple answer, yes. And they still haven't worked out. Because once you bare the ground, the grasshoppers can lay their eggs. If you don't have predatory insects, nematodes will eat the eggs if you have healthier soil. If you've got spiders and insects and tree breaks and healthy grasslands, it's all controlled. They still haven't worked out. And in fact, one of the interesting things about many regenerative farmers, especially in a very conservative district like ours, is that you're often very much alone. The neighbours tend to think you're a bit mad. And it's high risk socially for them to change. And so a lot of us, our community is often wider. It's only out of 1,000 farmers in our region, it's probably only 8 of us doing this. So our network of support and learning is wider, including across into the States and Europe. And it's more of a worldwide community with your reading and your networking and your contacting. So whilst in one way you're isolated, in another way you're not. You can tap into the minds and energy of wonderful people worldwide.
It just would seem to me that if you have stopped the devastation from grasshopper plagues, if you can get the yield at 1/10 of the cost that it would be necessary using chemicals, that there would be huge interest in all of the farmers around Australia, for sure. I mean, we'll just stay in Australia. I'm sure it's a worldwide phenomenon. But what is there a momentum happening? And if not, what's getting in the way and what needs to happen?
There's two things there, Cheryl, because that is such a key question. Yes, there's a rapid change on. Those of us that have been talking in this space, 5 years ago, you'd go out to a country town to an organised meeting, you might get 20 people and a couple of dogs sitting at the back. Today, it's 150, 200, 250, even bigger internationally. So there's definitely a shift on. But why locally, and this is a worldwide phenomenon, Alan Savory, who developed that grazing, talked about the 100-mile barrier. It's often easier for someone to go outside a district, pinch a new idea, come in and be seen as an innovator than to adopt locally. And it comes back to, and this is part of my PhD, and I won't go into it, but there's a psychological process, how we form human ideas or constructs, and it's linked to metaphors. And so when I talk about the mechanical mind, when you've, like I did at 22, taking over a farm, you become locked into a worldview. It's reinforced by neighbours and scientists and Department of Agriculture people and research. At your friends and your peers, you adopt a worldview or a paradigm. And one of the hardest things in life is to change a paradigm because it has deep psychological lock-in implications in the way we're wired in our brain. You know, you've got to get into cognitive psychology to understand it. So overthrowing it is not easy. And to illustrate that, I interviewed 80 lead farmers for my PhD, and some of those stories went into the book, which is not really academic. It's more about story. But in 60% of the cases, those farmers had changed from traditional industrial to regenerative because they'd had some major life shock in their life. They'd burned in a bushfire, been poisoned with chemicals, had a marriage breakup, et cetera, et cetera. That's how powerful that mind is. It's like a tortoise shell. You almost need a hammer to crack it open for those new ideas to seep in. But so that's on one hand, but there's more and more shocks coming. The droughts are bigger, the chemical costs are more, people get poisoned, et cetera, et cetera. And the change is occurring, and it's now accelerating, and that's noticeable worldwide. I know it's happening in the States, because I was there early in the year and late last year, and it's happening worldwide. And I think as things get worse climatically, with the Anthropocene, that pressure will trigger even faster change. That's why I'm pretty positive we might get to a tipping point where it will be a whole-scale shift. It relates to human health so much. If the average person buying off a supermarket shelf or at one of the big junk food takeaway places realised that that food is full of poisons and crap and stimulating their triggering all their unhealth. That should trigger a huge shift as well. But anyway, one step at a time, isn't it? Hence your program that you run so brilliantly.
Well, I think that's what crisis is for. Crisis is such an opportunity. Is that Chinese calligraphy figure, crisis is also an opportunity to transform and wake up. It could be disaster, it could be opportunity to wake up. And I think that is so much of what's going on. It takes a crisis like those people you interviewed for your book to crack open a space, to open a possibility that wasn't available for whatever reasons, however we are programmed and whatever, conditioning we have. And it's true in personal lives, too. As a psychotherapist and as a naturopath, I see that. It's like, the crisis in one's life can be such a blessing when you have hindsight. It's not pleasant when you're in it, but when you navigate through that time, it opens up such possibilities that you didn't even know were there. And I trust that is an accelerating process going on right now. Because, for me, when I heard you speak, and just even in this conversation, really, it touched my heart. It opened me up. It is hope, because it's so easy to look around and see every system that's failing and miss that there is something else going on. There really is a transformation occurring. We are in a time of rebirth. And old systems are failing, but there are new systems and new awarenesses and new strategies and new technologies that can help to repair and regenerate these systems. That's what I hold to be true anyway, and what you're doing reaffirms it, to be honest.
Cheryl, 100% agree. That circle of life, we're into a new rebirth phase, as I see it. It's accelerating, and it's holistic. I mean, nothing is ever not holistic, but in this case, it's not just regenerative agriculture, it's human health, is what you've just spoken about with your skill set and knowledge approach, which is holistic, I know. And it all seems to be connecting, and, from the soil up. And I think that's what's exciting, and, what people like Paul Hawken are doing, and there's so many good people working across the whole spectrum of fields. And that's what keeps me going, and I think that's the hope we have to grasp, that we are an extraordinary species. We're our own worst enemy when our huge brain does not think holistically but thinks mechanistically and reductionistically, which is what industrial agriculture... And for God's sake, if you look at human civilizations, all great civilizations have told themselves a great story, whether it's the emperor or the king or a religion. Post the rise of the mechanical mind and modern capitalism, we now tell ourselves what in reality is a totally suicidal story of economic rationalism. Economic rationalism, neoliberalism, whatever you want to call it, means growth for the sake of growth, which equals endless destruction. So I think the story you and I talk about is one of renewal, the cycle of life, regeneration, totally the opposite of an unsustainable, destroy-at-all-costs approach for maximum profit. So that's one of the things that we first of all have to address, the great story that we tell ourselves as a civilization. And I think I talk about an underground insurgency playing on the soil, obviously, but I see the sort of stuff you're working in, which connects with what we're working in, as we're sort of the insurgents working from underneath. And your average food consumer can become an insurgent. They can go and buy healthy food off healthy landscapes and source healthy products, or grow their own vegetable garden or have a community garden, source sensible health stimulating products, et cetera, just like we farmers can shift and so we're insurgents, We're insurgents to save the planet and save humanity.
Yes, indeed, we are insurgents. So what would you say to people listening who may have a small backyard garden? They have a little patch of some veggies or, maybe a little hobby farmer, as they call them in Australia. What would you say to those people? What could they do to start improving what they're doing and be able to establish more of a regenerative agriculture approach?
Well, I think when you see how a healthy soil biology works to concentrate extraordinary nutrients, minerals, micronutrients into food plants, and compare that to what's happening with industrial foods that are either over-processed or grown on sterilized landscapes full of poison. One gives health and life, one undermines it. So if it's possible, and everyone's busy, I know often husband and wife or partners are working and all the rest of it, but if you've got some spare ground in your backyard, even if it's only growing herbs or a bit of green spinach and stuff, but if you can grow at least some of your diet in healthy soil using biological inputs and harvest that regularly, it is probably one of the best things you can do for yourself and your family. Not possible, I know, in busy lives, but the more you can do, that simple step is probably one of the best things you could do for your own health, mental and physical, because getting your hands in the earth, learning about growing, watching the insects that come in and the birds, and maybe growing a few other plants that stimulates more biodiversity. It's all a wonderful, exciting journey that opens up other vistas.
We are in a, here in Oklahoma, a monarch butterfly migratory route. And, of course, there's a lot of concern about the monarch butterflies being killed because they don't have a habitat anymore. So there are so many people here that are growing the plants that feed the monarch butterflies. So they come through, and they're monarch butterfly areas or gardens for the monarch butterflies that you can walk through, and you just see all these butterflies, not just monarch butterflies, coming and visiting and taking the sap out of the plants, whatever they're doing there. And it's just a marvel, and to see this resurgence in wanting to save the monarch butterflies, so people are out there planting milkweed and other things that really will support them, is gaining a lot of momentum. So I think that's part of this new awareness and the fact that we can take action, even in a small way. And I just want to say one other thing before we conclude. You talked about worm juice, and I know that that's the castings, worm castings, and the juice, the water that comes out of the castings. That you can do that in your own backyard, right? You can have a little worm farm and take those castings or take that water, that juice, and put it into your garden, and that in itself can be so profound and regenerative.
Sure, well, absolutely. I mean, Charles Darwin wrote a whole book on earthworms in the 1880s telling us how wonderful they were. We now know from modern science that it's not just a few castings that the worms have got. They've got this extraordinary juice that comes out of compost where they work away, that or in your worm farm, as you pointed out, which anyone can grow in their backyard. It's full of all sorts of microbiology and other goodies, and it's one of the other exciting things you can do. And once you start doing that and growing milkweed and stuff for your monarchs, we have the same species here called the wanderer. We call him the wanderer, most gorgeous big butterfly. But once you take those steps, you start to re-engage with nature. Your mind begins that shift from a mechanical to an organic empathy with nature, and you have this cascading impact of returning to the way we were designed, I believe, rather than the opposite. So there's so many ways that each of us can play a role, whether you're lucky, privileged to have a few thousand acres or a small urban block. Just re-engaging mm-hmm. with nature is number one.
Yeah, that's just so, so important to be able to reconnect again. So, as we've come to the end, if people want to know more about regenerative agriculture, what do you recommend they do? Where should they go? What should they read?
Look, there's some of my favorite writers come out of the States. I've been privileged to have a day with Wendell Berry, for example, one of my great heroes. You've got Wes Jackson, Fred Kashineman. You've got lots of writers. Your innovative writers are over there. If you Google regenerative agriculture or organic agriculture, the States has a plethora of really good organisations doing different things, whether it's farming, vegetables, cropping, grazing or whatever. So it'd be just getting on, without mentioning a major commercial scene, but, you know, getting on the internet and you'll find both local and national the organisations you want. And check out catalogues in publishers like Chelsea Green and Acres USA. Acres USA is a great publisher of regenerative agriculture, farming books. You've got the Rodale Society over there, et cetera, et cetera. In many ways, post the Second World War, America has led a lot of this, but it's now a worldwide interaction, and we're sort of working together. So I think you'll find a heap of material. Sierra Club as well, all those sort of people you've got over there.
And there's always your book, which is published by Chelsea Green, which is Call of the Reed Warbler, A New Agriculture. And Charles Massy, it's just been so wonderful to have you with us today all the way from Australia, and we're so grateful to the wonderful work you are doing worldwide to bring about this new renaissance to help us evolve in the next cycle of life on this planet. It's really uplifting, it's inspiring, and it certainly has made my day. And I just want to thank you again for all the wonderful things you're doing out there in the world.
Look, thank you, Cheryl. It's been a pleasure, likewise, and my best wishes to you for all the work you're doing and also your listeners. So huge thanks.
You're so welcome. And to all my listeners, thank you for joining me again once more for a wonderful conversation. I know you'll be back every week. And remember, I also have a second podcast on this network every Saturday at 11, which is called The Love Code. But if you go to my website, Dr. Cheryl Selman, or to my Facebook page, which is What Women Must Know, I post those shows or send them out to you if you've opted into my site, so you won't be able to miss any of them, and you don't really want to. So until next week, always honor the wisdom of your feminine self. Bye for now.